Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing this morning? Pretty good, yeah? Well, I just, again, want to say thank you for having me out here. This is the biggest opportunity that I've ever had, and I'm so glad to be sitting next to Mindy today, and I'm really excited for this session.
Well, I'm as thrilled. Good morning, everyone, and to have you do this interview, considering we spent time together last year and got an update, is fantastic.
Yeah, so I think to kick off this chat, I've heard about your story at multiple NRF functions in the past. And what I've really taken away from it is your ability to take intelligent risks. You've had a very non-linear career path, which just amazes me every time I hear about it. So would you mind sharing that story with the audience?
Sure. You just have to promise if you decide to do what I did, I'm not going to get blamed by your parents. It was very interesting. I had an interesting life growing up. I was an adopted kid, first one to go to college in my family. And so I was very serious very early on because I felt this responsibility of having to do and be the first. And I graduated high school at 16. I got engaged to my high school sweetheart at 19. I was an English literature and philosophy major, and I was planning to go to law school. So I always joke around, it was, you know, every Jewish mother stereotype dream. And, you know, I was in my last semester of college, and I say I woke up one morning, but it, you know, I'm sure it was built up. And I realized that I wasn't living my life of passion. I was doing something because I felt I had to. And that's not a path, and that's not a way to have a fulfilling life. And I made the very hard decision to stop right there, and I called my parents and said, I have got something to tell you. Number one, I'm not getting married. Number two, I'm not going to law school. And number three, I'm moving to New York right now, and I'm going to figure it out. And that's what I did. And I knew that the path for me was going to be one that was more creative. And I realized today that what I really wanted to accomplish, but I probably couldn't articulate it in the same way, I wanted to be in the business of making creativity successful. And so I moved to New York in 1977. Boy, did I feel old when I just heard four decades. Wow. I ended up starting in the menswear industry at a company working for their head of international licensing. I ended up taking classes at FIT at night in textile technology and other aspects of the industry to really learn about it. Started building my career, my relationship. So, you know, that moment of realizing, you know, I needed to make that change really reinforced for me that not taking a risk is actually more dangerous than taking the intelligent risk. And clearly there's a difference between risk and suicide, right? But if you're going to take those risks, do it early, right? Because if I had waited 10 years, who knows what my life would have been like. And so after that, nothing really seems very scary to me, because what's the worst thing that can happen? You course correct.
That sounds great. And I mean, the biggest thing that I take away from that is do it early. And we're seeing all of these early faces in the audience with us here today.
And I think also do what you're passionate about. Sandy mentioned, you know, there's three mantras I really have in my life. Do what you're passionate about, because then it's not work, right? But have it be purposeful. Have it take you somewhere and have it put you on a path. And I think the third thing is aim to have impact. Impact in your first job, you know, or, you know, for me, almost 40 years later, impact on, you know, whether it's the NRF Foundation or my work with UNICEF or my company, aim to have impact and aim to make other people successful. Don't be thinking so far in advance about yourself. Just do what's great and have the impact in whatever role you're in.
And so you mentioned that you have some time that you've spent with UNICEF, and recently you were awarded at their Snowflake Ball. Can you talk a little bit more about what really inspires you about this organization that deals with child protection and development? Yeah.
So, you know, if you sit back, let's just talk about impact in general. And, you know, I do believe that fundamentally we as human beings need to work to make a mark. And whether you're just starting out or whether, you know, you're at the point in my career where I have a platform that can really make a difference. And, you know, when we started HSN Cares, when Bill Brand joined the company and I, you know, we said that we have a responsibility as a company and with our consumers. And we determined that empowering women, because it's most of our customers, and helping children and family needs were going to be our foundation. And that's always been important to me. I believe in education. I believe in fostering our next generation of talent. And having the impact globally now to be able to do that is incredible. And I've been on two field trips with UNICEF, one to Africa, to Senegal, and one recently to Guatemala. And I remember the trip to Senegal, I brought my daughter, who was 23 at the time, and we went through this incredible trip together. And I remember coming back and a couple days later having dinner, and I talked about what I took away from the trip and the impact that I could have. And that impact is so much more than writing a check. It's using your platform to really talk about change and purpose. And I remember saying to her, what was your biggest impact? And she said, Mom, a dollar really does make a difference. And whether that is about philanthropy, or whether it's about your role in an organization or who you are as a person, making a difference, and again, having that impact can be done. Just think about that. Wake up every morning and say, what impact can I have every single day? That's very empowering. And it's going to make people recognize that you're there for a bigger purpose.
Definitely. So one of the things that I noticed taking a step back is being a student in the audience. Sometimes there's a disconnect because they see these great CEOs coming up on stage for the next generation of scholarships and all of these great people on stage, but they see this big divide between being a student and being a CEO of a multi-million dollar company. Can you talk us through some of the traits that you saw in yourself very early on from your college days and talk about how that still sticks with you today and resonates with you?
Sure. So first of all, when I started in my career, I don't think I even knew what a CEO really was, right? It was, you know, probably just someone in the, you know, the distance. So I think, you know, for me, I never totally woke up focusing on what my next step was. I focused on making other people successful. And again, I have to use the word impact because I wasn't concerned how people were going to look at me. I knew that if I could make them successful, I'd make the company successful, and ultimately I would be more successful. And I use this expression, you want to live a life and you want to be in a culture of generosity. And what I mean by that is, what's your ability to give without expecting something in return? And whether it's supporting who you work for, or your business, or another individual, that's going to pay you back in spades. So that was number one. Number two, the power of building relationships, meaningful relationships, authentic relationships. You know, I always say that I'm not going to be the smartest person in the room, but boy, am I going to surround myself with great people? Am I going to build a network? And for example, when I started at HSN, it was a very unconventional move for me to go from Nike to HSN and transform a business. And I couldn't have done it alone. I need people who were fellow risk takers who believed in me, that were going to support me. And some of those relationships I had built over the course of 30, 35 years. And you build the credibility, that authentic credibility, where people will take the risk with you because they know that you do know the difference between risk and suicide, and you have a vision. So I would say that. The third, which I think is so important, is this idea of intellectual curiosity. I am a very non-linear thinker. I love trying to connect two dots that look like they have nothing to do one another, but when you put them together, they create something. And so this idea that inspiration comes from everywhere, I am voracious, whether it's consuming information, going out into the marketplace and seeing new things, talking to people in different industries. So if you're in the beauty business and you have an opportunity to go to the Consumer Electronics Show, see how technology is transforming things. You know, don't stick in one lane. And I tell that to everyone. I think it's so important to get out there. And Matt made the comment, it's not networking, it's relationship building. So I think that is really important. And three, don't think that the road less traveled is more scary. It sometimes gives us the greatest opportunities because you may see something that other people don't see. But if you can go into something new, you know, my whole thing is transformation ultimately can create greater success than doing the status quo. So I think I was always that kind of thinker, and I wasn't afraid to try new things. And I was always like that, and you know, sometimes they're crazy. I mean, there's plenty of people that work with me that I know they walk out of the room and they're shaking their head going, what did she just say or do? And they're not always gonna be right. And then I'd say the last thing is don't minimize, right? Don't think incrementally. If you have an idea, vision it to the ultimate degree. Vision it to the ultimate degree. You may not be able to start there, but if you only have the vision to here, everything's going to be incremental. You're not going to make bold leaps. You're not going to make bold moves. You're not going to, you know, take businesses and yourself somewhere. So set that vision further in, you know, advance for any idea that you have.
I think those are great pieces of advice. I wish I had like paper and pen. I could be taking notes because one of the things that, you know, the company I work at is bold moves, and we really, you know, look into how can we do the next big thing and, you know, making some of those risks, but making sure they're intelligent risks while you're.
Yeah, and you know, again, moves aren't linear. I think in the, you know, when I first started, people felt that their trajectory had to be vertical. Today, it's very, very, very different. And I think about my own career, you know, I spent my first 18 years in the menswear industry. And, you know, it's just funny. So I really wanted to transition from menswear into women's and get some different experiences. And I remember talking to recruiters and they said, you have no women's experience. And I went, okay, wait. I've been in the menswear industry for 18 years and I'm a woman. I think I might have skills that are gonna transfer. And when I started Polo Jeans Company, you know, it was men's and women's and I was able to get that experience. I think people are a little bit more open today to transferable skills. And then when, you know, I left Polo Jeans to go to Nike, it was the same sort of thing. I didn't have experience in the sport industry. You know, I was not an athlete per se, but I embraced the brand and understanding, you know, what I could do in the business. And then when I made the move to HSN, and people thought I was, you know, a little crazy, you know, I didn't have retail background. I didn't have media and television background. I didn't have background in a lot of the businesses that we were in, but I saw an opportunity and it was very strategic. I believed in the world was going to be about owning the consumer, right? Again, you heard Matt talk about the consumer landscape and the importance of really focusing on that. So owning that direct relationship with the customer I felt was going to be important. I felt that technology was going to change everything. It was going to change how people shopped. It was going to change how people consume media. I had the opportunity at Nike to be traveling around the world and seeing the explosion of mobile in Japan. I knew I wanted something entrepreneurial. I love that. And I knew I was at a point in my career that I wanted to do something very different. So what looked on the surface to people as a very non-linear segue made perfect sense to me. And I'm a very big believer in making lists. Because over the course of your career, you're all the top talent. So you're going to get recruited. You're going to have people come to you. But it's also about deciding what you want. And at different points in your career, make the list. You know, for me, it was like, okay, if I'm going to do something else, here are my criteria. So when something did come to me, I had a filter. And I knew what that filter was. And I think that's very important because as you progress in your career, you're going to know yourself better. And I'd say the one other thing and advice that I would give everyone in this room, I think the most powerful weapon anyone can have is self-awareness. Know yourself, know your impact on others, know the impact within your organization, and know your strengths and know your weaknesses. I gather there's probably not one person in this room who's truly perfect, and if there is, please come and meet me after, I'm curious. The reality is that, you know, when I was at Nike, I worked with a coach for 5 years, and I found there were so many things that I could do better and lead better and motivate people better and develop people better and develop myself better. At this point in my life, I'm not going to change, but I can be more self-aware of my actions and my impact on others, which in turn is going to improve the performance of the company. It's going to make me a more effective leader. So I would say, really, the more self-aware you can be, and ask people. Ask the people you work with, what could I do better? What greater impact can I have? Where do you see development strengths? I think that's not a negative. That's a huge positive.
Definitely. And one of those things that goes with that is that you've had a lot of mentors that have kind of helped you along this process. And I know when I first started my career 6 months ago, the first thing I did was find a mentor at the same level as me, someone I could look up to and really emulate. And, you know, I think that's been a huge game changer for me so far in my career. Do you have any advice for these students of qualities that you would look for personally in a mentee?
Yeah, I think that mentorship is really interesting. I think the best, let's call it mentorship, is not forced, right? It's not, I want you as a mentor and we're going to meet once a month. It's not like that, right? And it's not just one mentor, right? I think what you want to do is connect with people that, A, are authentic, that you believe have a quality or a talent or a value that you want to learn from, and they can come from anywhere. I've had incredible mentors in people like Phil Knight or Ralph Lauren or Tommy Hilfiger, who, you know, is still a good friend of mine today, but they're all very different, and I've taken away different things from each one. But just to give you now another idea, I've started angel investing in a lot of entrepreneurial businesses started up by women. I'm learning as much, if not more, from them that they potentially believe that they're learning from me, because it's a different generation. And I'm learning what it's like to be an entrepreneur today and what sort of things do you need to be thinking of in business today and how is consumer behavior changing and what is that next generation of consumers. So don't always think that a mentor is up. It's the collective capabilities. And, you know, I started Nike's first Women's Leadership Council, and we started this women's series where we'd interview different women executives from across the company. And what I said to women is go to each one of them, because not one woman is going to emulate you. Not one person is going to emulate you. But you might take one idea from here and go, that relates to me, or one idea from here and that relates to me. And it's the accumulation of that that you then say, this is who I am. This is the type of leader I am. This is what I bring to the table. And it's the collectiveness of that combined with the self-awareness that I think is very important.
Definitely. So as we start wrapping up, everyone in the audience know that you're going to have some time to start thinking of questions that you'd like to ask Mindy. So to wrap this up between us, I've got some quick-fire questions for you, just quick answers. So what kinds of people inspire you?
I think I love creativity. Mm-hmm. I love authenticity. And I like people with inspired visions. People that don't just think of what's in front of them, but they dream with intent. And that really gets me excited and motivated. And even when I look for people that are going to work within the culture of our company, that idea of intellectual curiosity, I say, you know, everybody's been talking about the three C's of content, community, commerce. And I said, there's three C's of people. And I use the expression cool, curious, and connected. And cool does not mean how you dress. I want to be clear. It means you're interesting. It means I want to be with you. I want to have dinner with you. I want to hear your ideas. Because if you're really interesting, it's probably because you're interested and you are intellectually curious, and it means you're connected. It means you probably surround yourself with people like you. And so that sort of thing is really important to me.
Inspiring, definitely. Okay, so what was your favorite subject when you were in school?
Oh, I loved English literature, and you know, not just English literature, any form of literature. I still, to this day, I'm a voracious reader. I loved everything from medieval all the way to modern European, and I could immerse myself in that.
And so you talked about reading. Last year at the student program, you said you were reading Crazy as a Compliment, which is an amazing book, and I think half of the students in the audience probably went and bought it. What are you reading right now?
Well, what I'm very excited about, so I'm obsessed with a gentleman named Adam Grant. And he was the youngest tenured professor at Stanford. He's now at Wharton. And he wrote a book called Give and Take, which I think every single one of you in the audience, you need to read. And the premise of Give and Take is that there are three types of people: givers, takers, and matchers. And ultimately, givers with a purpose, that idea of generosity and what are you trying to do, are going to be the most successful. He has a new book coming out. I was very fortunate to get an advance copy. It's called Originals, and I think it's available for pre-sale. It comes out February 2nd, and it's about not just entrepreneurs, but the spirit of originality and what it means and who are the thinkers and what's happening today. So I would say that both of those, and then there's another book called Multipliers, which is in that same kind of theme, that there really are two types of leadership. You can be a multiplier, which means everything you do and the impact you have makes things grow, or you can be a diminisher, and ultimately that'll bring things in. So I think it may just be where my head is, you know, now, of what's really important in how you lead and what you do, but I would recommend those very highly.
Great. So one final question. What's next for you, for HSN, and for the retail industry?
You know, I could not be more excited. And I think, you know, we're in a crazy environment right now. It's very disruptive. There's a tremendous amount of change. And you could look at that two ways. You could look at that and be defensive, or you can look at that and be offensive. And I think you lean into it, because there's so much that's exciting. And our world is changing, but we have to think differently. We have to realize that the next 3 to 5 years, and the opportunities to truly think of boundaryless retail, to truly think of distributed commerce, and where you're going to reach audience, and how are you going to get your products and your brands and your businesses, you know, using technology to create these experiences for people. How are you going to differentiate in a very commoditized world? How are you going to create relationships and experiences with your brands and people? I think it's the most exciting time. And certainly in our company, we're really embracing that. And we're investing in everything from technology to talent. How do you use data analytics in a very different way because of the capabilities we have today? So I'm very excited about the future. From a retail perspective and an industry perspective of what we can do. I think the other thing is, there's no straight lines anymore. What's a retailer? What's a media company? And what's a technology company? They're all melding. And we have to think of ourselves in very different ways and how we think about things. We have to think very horizontally versus vertically. We have to think of 360 degrees of experience. And that's very exciting. And then on a personal level, you know, I'm very focused on this idea of, you know, how can I have the greatest impact beyond myself? You know, one of the things that my husband and I have done, which has been very fulfilling, we've endowed scholarship programs at Columbia, Hebrew University, and in, you know, in Florida. And we're very focused. He's a mathematical physicist, believe it or not. So our conversations are very interesting. But we endow scholarships to women and underserved minorities who are getting their PhDs in science, technology, engineering, and math, and have the ability to interface with those scholars. And, you know, I think that's really exciting. And then, you know, the work that I'm doing with angel investing and supporting young emerging businesses, that's very, very fulfilling to me.
And the work you do for the NRF, because
I love my NRF
work. We wouldn't be here without you.
Matt Shea knows I'm like the biggest evangelist in the world. I so believe in the foundation and the impact we can have on the entire industry. And what could be more inspiring than just thinking of the words, you know, the next generation of retail and having an impact on that? I think it's incredibly exciting.
Exactly. And, you know, these students out here could potentially be sitting in this chair one day. So I think...
Well, I hope so.
Hopefully.
Well, maybe it's a completely different chair.
Yeah. But. So I think we have some time to take some questions from the audience. There's some microphones up front. People want to line up.
Hello. I'm Olivia Gayfield, representing Georgia Southern University. Thank you for coming today. My first question is, what knowledge did you bring from your previous work experience at the top companies that you were at that have helped shape that helped shape your brand now?
You know, I think that the true understanding of brand and what a brand means and the storytelling aspects. And when I use the word experience, I think that the retail industry, we, more than any other industry, are the greatest storytellers. And that idea of being able to decipher the DNA of a brand, and look, I learned at the foothold of Nike, of Ralph, of Tom, who are probably of a brand essence and storytellers the best, but they're very different. So at Nike, it's inspiration and innovation to every athlete. It's Ralph Lauren transporting you into another world. But I think no matter what you're doing, whether you're working on a product, whether you're working for a brand, whether you're working for a company, that idea of a storytelling platform and understanding how you have to reach consumers through experience is very, very important.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Tess Williamson from Texas A&M University, and I know you mentioned angel investing, and I would like to know what qualities you look for in those entrepreneurs as well as what the vision they have for their businesses.
Yeah. You know, I think that everyone has different philosophies around investing depending on their knowledge base, and my husband, who's a professional in finance, he's going to look at it very differently. You know, I put a lens over it of what I'm passionate about and where I think I could add value beyond just an investment. So I look for creative founders who have a vision and who are creating something differentiated in what they're trying to do, that they have a passion, but they have a plan. A lot of people can be passionate, but what is the plan to really execute against the business? So I do spend a lot of time thinking about it, and I look at a lot of different things. And you can't invest in everything. And it's interesting because there are entrepreneurs I've met that I haven't yet invested in, but I've stayed connected with because I find it very interesting. So for me, they're more in the consumer space because that's what I know, and that's where I think I can add value. And I think the other thing for me, if I'm going to invest, and these are not huge investments, they're there, I have to be willing that not everything is going to work. And, you know, if you read about different entrepreneurial ventures, some don't succeed the first time, but sometimes those people go on to creating the next big thing. But you learn a lot. And as I mentioned before, I'm learning as much as I believe I'm contributing.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Austin. I'm from LaSalle College. Good morning, by the way. So I resonate a lot with your abrupt switch in your fields. I started off thinking I was going to go to college for a double major in poli sci in criminal justice, and then I switched to fashion merchandising in the middle of the entire process.
Perfect segue.
Yeah. I thought I was gonna be a lot happier, and I am. But I've had a lot of jobs ranging from being a service technician to being a contractor. And I just wanna know, what do you look for on a resume? Do you look for diversity, or do you look for like in-depth work in a field and knowledge about the subject?
You know, I really look for diversity and the experiences that people had, and I look for the story of why. What were those transitions? Now, obviously, it also depends on the role that you're recruiting for. So, you know, if I'm looking for a head of IT and they have no IT experience, it's probably a problem, right? But I really like people who've tried different things. And that doesn't mean only tried them in the workplace. I'm really interested in what else have people done. You know, what things are you involved with? Where do you get your inspiration? You know, what other things have you done? And they could be things in the community. They could be travel experiences. And it goes back to, I really want to know that you've got the intellectual curiosity to do different things, and then you have the strength to make a shift if you think that's the right thing to do. But Sandy Soto will tell you that when we even work with search firms, the reason why they like working with our company is we say, bring us the out-of-the-box people. Because if you get too narrow in how you define what you want, you're going to not meet some of the best talented people out there because you're being too rigid. So you have to be open to alternative experience. And I think that's sometimes where you find the most interesting people.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Jing. I'm from LaSalle College in Massachusetts. So you gave up a lot of advice. The first golden rule is how to make other people success. And then my question is, does it apply to everyone or just apply to the successful people like you?
Thanks. No, I really believe that whether it's your business life or your personal life, really focusing on how you can add value to people. Now, you want to do that for people that you feel are worthwhile, right? Not everyone is magnanimous, right? But the reality is, throughout your career, you're gonna work for some people you love, you're gonna work for some people you like, and you know, I've had the good, the bad, and the ugly, right, throughout my career. But if my focus has been on making the business successful or building a successful team, that's ultimately gonna come back to me. And it goes for your personal relationships too. You know, that idea of generosity, there's so many times that I'll see something and I'll go, my God, this person needs to see this because it's really gonna be great for them. There's no value to me in it, but by doing those things, next time that person sees something, they may think of me. So I just think, again, whether it's personal, whether it's professional, that idea of generosity or that idea of focus on, you know, how you can be. And it doesn't mean you don't have an ego. It doesn't mean you don't want to get ahead. There's nothing wrong with a certain amount of ego. You know, when you have to run an organization and you have to inspire an organization, you know, you need to have belief. So that's okay. But if you really focus on, you know, those core things, I think ultimately you'll be more successful and you'll be more fulfilled, frankly.
Okay, thanks. Hi, my name's Karen Cox. I'm an MBA at Georgetown, actually. And I found what you said earlier about intelligent risk so inspiring. How does that attitude permeate the companies that you run, and how do you encourage that within your people?
Yeah, I do think that encouraging what I would call intelligent risk-taking, right, is very important, because especially in an industry that's going through such change as ours, safe is not an option, because not taking any of the risks and you just keep doing the same thing, ultimately you're going to be disrupted yourself. But you really have to spend a lot of time with people understanding the implications of risk. So let's say you run a division and, you know, you want to take a risk on, you know, a product. I'm just making it up. Well, what is the level of risk? Is it a risk you want to take just by testing it? Or you believe in it so strongly that you want to go all in? Have partners when you're taking that risk. And whether it's the people you work with or the people you work for, be able to go and articulate why you want to take that risk, what the measure is going to be of it working or not working. And I think that's really important. If you're going to take the risk, what do you want the outcome to be? And what are the steps along the way that's going to tell you if it's working or not? And then the last piece, fail fast. If you go into something and it really is not working, you know, wishing and hoping is not going to make it better. Just take the personal responsibility and say, you know what, we tried this, it's not going to work, but here is my plan now of what to do if it's not working. I have made more mistakes than you can imagine in your life, but you course correct, you move forward, and you learn from it. And I think that's what's also really important.
Thank you so much.
Good morning. My name is Alex Larson, and I'm a senior at Indiana University. Many of us today are leaders around our campus or in student organizations, and so I was hoping that you could share some advice on how you aim to lead in a way that inspires and empowers all of your employees.
Yeah. So I think that, you know, and you asked me before what I look at in people, this idea of inspiration and being able to articulate a vision, be able to take people and on a journey of where you're going and give them a sense of what their role in that journey is, to me is a very important characteristic of leadership, particularly if you're trying to create change and you're trying to motivate people and you're trying to create a dynamic culture. When I came to HSN and we had to completely change the business and we had to impact our culture, I remember I started there in May 2006. In October, it was Halloween, I remember, we erected a giant tent on campus. And we had the entire company and by video. And, you know, I got up there and said, here's where we're going. And we're going to be a disruptive force on the retail landscape. And those weren't just words. You know, we did a multimedia presentation of and a manifesto to the customer. But we tried to inspire each individual person on what they could do to have an impact. So think about what's going to inspire people. Think about the vision you want to set and really give people the tools on how they can play a part in that. And I think that's very important. And of course, it goes without saying, have it be authentic, because if you don't believe in it yourself, nobody else is going to believe in it.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Chanel, and I go to the Savannah College of Art and Design. So we talked about having like a non-linear career path. So my question is, so what is the best way to combat people who sort of have a closed mind and you're applying to like a different sort of sector in the fashion market? What's the best way that we can sort of apply to jobs cross-market when we're applying at an entry level?
So I think if you're looking to segue, for example, mm-hmm. and you're meeting with someone who may not quite get it, spend the time articulating what your experiences, what your skills, and what you would bring to the table in this other industry and why it's applicable. So if you're going from, fashion to beauty, right? Why? What do you know about the beauty business? What about your fashion background would actually be of great value, even more maybe than somebody who's only been in beauty? What other skill sets do you bring to the table? Why do you want to work at that particular company or that brand? Like, come armed with the tools on the offense. Don't be defensive, right? Don't go in thinking, you know, I'm segueing and I don't have the skills. Go in thinking, here are the skills I'm bringing. And I think, you know, look, there are some people you're never going to win over. And you know what? At some point, stop trying. You know, it's kind of, you know, when I came into the company, there were three sorts of people. They're the evangelists that get things right away. They're the wait and see. And then there are the blockers. You're not going to change the blockers. So you know, move on. But people who are at least somewhat open have the tools at your disposal, and you need to sell yourself authentically, but with the skills of what you're bringing to the company, right? When you go in for an interview, the way to think about it is, what am I bringing to the company, right? And what's the company gonna, you know, not what, what's the company gonna do for you? What are you gonna do for them?
Okay, thank you.
Sarah Alexander, Wheaton College, Massachusetts. So I wanted to share something with you guys. So you were talking about the give and take book, and you've continued talking more about how you need to give to people. So I follow a girl, and she has more of a help yourself mentality, where she likes to follow, you know, what she thinks works best for her instead of thinking about other people. And she says, this is a quote, don't cross oceans for people who wouldn't cross a puddle for you. And when we really should be thinking about how we can aim to help other people be more successful, that's a quote from you. And then it says, no, do it. Do cross oceans for people, love people, all people, no conditions attached. No wondering whether or not they're worthy. Cross oceans, climb mountains. Life and love isn't about what you can gain, it's about what you can give.
Absolutely.
And so I said, this is a great way to look at personal relationships, business circles, and the way that you make yourself successful as long as other people.
I love that. I agree completely.
Yeah, I just thought it was a great quote.
Thank you.
Yep.
Hi, my name is Tabitha Sloan, and I study apparel merchandising and product development at Bowling Green State University. And I just wanted to ask, with Lori Greener's role in Shark Tank, QVC has found its way in the homes of the many, being that she is also a top person in the live broadcast. How is HSN staying relevant still
within
sure. being a competitor?
So has anyone seen the movie Joy? Okay. So Joy Mangano, who's a very inspiring person, we own that company. And certainly we're, you know, she's one of our largest businesses. And, you know, we actually, not only on HSM, but we've now had big launches. She had a personal appearance at Macy's on Saturday, rollout at Target, rollout at Container Store, Bed Bath & Beyond. I have an event Tuesday night, which I'm excited about with Hearst and Good Housekeeping with Joy. We're gonna make some announcements on what we're doing. So that's, you know, that's kind of, you know, an opportunity. The real foundation of what we're doing is we really believe that our power is as, and not just a retailer, right? We are about experience. So ideas, information, education, entertainment. We have partnerships with everyone from Disney to Universal to Paramount to Norwegian Cruise Lines to Ford to Aetna to what you would consider celebrity as well as, you know, every other. We're in 96 million homes. We're the only company that has shop by remote. We have 40% of our business through a digital platform. And what's most exciting to me is that our future is not just about customers coming to us. It's about really using our technology, our content and experience to get out with them. We have a partnership with Univision. We power their boutique Univision. We've just launched joymangano.com. And so it really is that holistic 360-degree view of our brands, our products, and our businesses that create relevance beyond ourselves. And that's what's really exciting.
Thank you so much. And I just want to say, you know, for a lot of the women out here, it's an honor to hear you speak, let alone get the chance to ask you a question. Oh. So thank you so much.
Thank
she
you.
She took the words out of my mouth. Can we please have a round of applause for Mindy?
Well, I want to give a round of applause to Sarah, too.
Thank you. Thank you.